Hezekiah began to reign when he was 25 years old. He reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Abijah, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that David his father had done. He, in the first year of his reign, in the first month, opened the doors of the house of the Lord and repaired them. And he brought the priests and the Levites and gathered them together into the east street and said unto them, Hear me, ye Levites, sanctify now yourselves and sanctify the house of the Lord God of your fathers, and carry forth the filthiness out of the holy place. For our fathers have trespassed, and done that which is evil in the eyes of the Lord our God, and have forsaken him, and have turned away their faces from the habitation of the Lord, and turned their backs. Also they have shut up the doors of the porch, and put out the lamps, and have not burned incense, nor offered burnt offerings in the holy place unto the God of Israel. Wherefore the wrath of the Lord was upon Judah and Jerusalem, and he hath delivered them to trouble, to astonishment, and to hissing, as ye see with your eyes. For lo, our fathers have fallen by the sword, and our sons and our daughters and our wives are in captivity for this. Now it is in mine heart to make a covenant with the Lord God of Israel, that his fierce wrath may turn away from us. My sons, be not now negligent, for the Lord hath chosen you to stand before him, to serve him, and that ye should minister unto him and burn incense. Then the Levites arose, Mahath the son of Amasai, and Joel the son of Azariah, of the sons of the Kohathites, and of the sons of Merari, Kish, and the son of Abdi, and Azariah, the son of Jehalelel, and of the Gershonites, Joah, the son of Zimmah, and Eden, the son of Joah. And of the sons of Elizaphan, Shimri, and Jael, and of the sons of Asaph, Zechariah, and Mathaniah, and of the sons of Heman, Jehiel and Shimei, and of the sons of Jeduthun, Shemaiah and Uziel. And they gathered their brethren and sanctified themselves, and came according to the commandment of the king by the words of the Lord to cleanse the house of the Lord. And the priest went into the inner part of the house of the Lord to cleanse it, and brought out all the uncleanness that they found in the temple of the Lord into the court of the house of the Lord, and the Levites took it to carry it out abroad into the brook Kidron. Now they began on the first day of the first month to sanctify, and on the eighth day of the month came they to the porch of the Lord. So they sanctified the house of the Lord in 8 days. In the 16th day of the first month they made an end. Then they went into Hezekiah the king and said, We have cleansed all the house of the Lord, and the altar of burnt offering, and all the vessels thereof, and the showbread table with all the vessels thereof. Moreover, all the vessels which King Ahaz in his reign did cast away in his transgression have we prepared and sanctified, and behold, they are before the altar of the Lord. Then Hezekiah the king arose early and gathered the rulers of the city and went up to the house of the Lord. And they brought 7 bullocks and 7 rams and 7 lambs and 7 he-goats for a sin offering for the kingdom and for the sanctuary and for Judah. And he commanded the priests, the sons of Aaron, to offer them on the altar of the Lord. So they killed the bullocks, and the priests received the blood and sprinkled it on the altar. Likewise, when they had killed the rams, they sprinkled the blood upon the altar. They killed also the lambs, and they sprinkled the blood upon the altar. And they brought forth the he-goats for a sin offering before the king and the congregation, and they laid their hands upon them. And the priests killed them, and they made reconciliation with their blood upon the altar, to make an atonement for all Israel. For the king commanded that the burnt offering and the sin offering should be made for all Israel. And he set the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals, with psalteries, and with harps, according to the commandment of David and of Gad, the king's seer, and Nathan the prophet, for so was the commandment of the Lord by his prophets. And the Levites stood with the instruments of David, and the priests with the trumpets, and Hezekiah commanded to offer the burnt offering upon the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord began also with the trumpet and with the instruments ordained by David, king of Israel. And all the congregation worshipped, and the singers sang, and the trumpeters sounded, and all this continued until the burnt offering was finished. And when they had made an end of offering, the king and all that were present with him bowed themselves and worshipped. Moreover, Hezekiah the king and the princes commanded the Levites to sing praise unto the Lord with the words of David and of Asaph the seer. And they sang praises with gladness, and they bowed their heads and worshipped. Then Hezekiah answered and said, "Now ye have consecrated yourselves unto the Lord. Come near and bring sacrifices and thank offerings into the house of the Lord." And the congregation brought in sacrifices and thank offerings, and as many as were a free heart burnt offerings. And the number of the burnt offerings which the congregation brought was 70 bullocks, 100 rams, and 200 lambs. All these were for a burnt offering to the Lord. And the consecrated things were 600 oxen and 3,000 sheep. But the priests were too few, so they could not flay all the burnt offerings. Wherefore their brethren the Levites did help them till the work was ended, and until the other priests had sanctified themselves. For the Levites were more upright in heart to sanctify themselves than the priests. And also the burnt offerings were in abundance, with the fat of the peace offerings and the drink offerings for every burnt offering. So the service of the house of the Lord was set in order. And Hezekiah rejoiced, and all the people, that God had prepared the people, for this thing was done suddenly. Thank you, Lord, for your word, God. I pray, God, that you would explain to us exactly what you want us to hear today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Talking today about cleaning house. Cleaning house. If you look in the beginning of chapter 29 there, we find Hezekiah beginning his reign, okay? And the Bible says in verse 2 that he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. He did that which was right in the sight of the Lord according to all that David his father had done. We should ask ourselves whenever we find somebody doing right in the Bible, hey, this is somebody we should grab a hold of and take as a good example. Are we doing right by God? Well, how do we right by God? It should always be the questions that come to our mind. The first thing that you see about Hezekiah is that he started young. The Bible records that he was 25 years old when he began to reign, when he began to reign and be king at this time. And so he started at a very young age. Myself, I resonate with this because I was saved at 25. So you could say that my journey as a king and priest under God began at 25 as well. At that time, I was very zealous. I was very excited about the things of God, sometimes without knowledge, albeit. But I did pretty much the way that Hezekiah did when I came to that kingship, that priesthood, when I came to the point where I was going to be serving God. I wanted to do what was right in the sight of the Lord, so we should take a man like this and also wish to do that which is right in the sight of the Lord. Start young, and here we have parents who would say the same thing to our kids. Hey, start serving God young. I mean, if we were to look back at our lives, I would even say that 25, I was pretty old. Because of all the years that had happened before that, all the mistakes, all the hurts, all the wrongs that had been done from, you know, 16 years up to 25, so many mistakes, so many hurts that still hurt me, scars that last to this day happened at that time. You want to start as young as possible, and today is the youngest you're ever going to be to make the decision to serve God. So start young, and the next thing you see is that he started early. In verse 3 it says, he, in the first year of his reign, in the first month, opened the doors of the house of the Lord and repaired them. So right off the bat, as soon as he was made king, in the first year, in the first month, he just got to it. Got to serving God, got to doing what God had laid on his heart. And the first thing that he wanted to do was to undo everything that had been done by his fathers before him. If you were to look back one chapter, you would see in 2 Chronicles 28, in verse 24, it says, "And Ahaz gathered together the vessels of the house of God, and cut in pieces the vessels of the house of God, and shut up the doors of the house of the Lord, and he made him altars in every corner of Jerusalem, and in every several city of Judah. He made high places to burn incense unto other gods, and provoked to anger the Lord God of his fathers. And this was basically the end of Ahaz's life. And he was Hezekiah's dad. And so you see, as soon as Hezekiah comes to power, and this is actually usually the contrary part. Usually a king that is wicked will beget a king that is wicked, will beget a king that is wicked. But we'll see throughout the Bible in the book of Chronicles and Kings, sometimes a king rises up in the stead of a wicked one and he reforms things. He cleans house, as it were. And that's what you find in Hezekiah. Another one that comes to mind is Josiah, who did great things to reform the worship and to change things to the better from what was before. We saw here that Ahaz, the dad of Hezekiah, he laid up high places to serve other gods, to burn incense to other gods. He took all the vessels that were to be used in the service of God, brought them together, cut them in pieces, likely to melt them down and use them for the altars that would come afterwards. And he just basically made of the house of the Lord a ruin. Even boarded up the house, he condemned the place so that no man would enter in. And yet we find his son, a wise son that comes after him, Hezekiah, at 25 years old, he looks at the works of his father Ahaz and shuns them, puts them away and says, I don't want to live like that. But the Bible records there in verse 2 that he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord according to all that David his father had done. And so what he did and what we need to do is be wise and look to the examples of our past that are righteous, the good examples, the positive examples. And sometimes for some of us, we have to go back a few generations. Sometimes for some of us, we don't even have anybody in our foreseeable lineage that would be doing that which was right, in the sight of the Lord. We almost have to rewrite the book, as it were, go to the scriptures and find out exactly what God would want for us, because there isn't a good example in the past. There isn't a righteous example to follow. But hey, if we have the scriptures, we can always do what Hezekiah did and follow that example of our father David, of our father Abraham, of the men that went before us and did right. And even we stand here today and we can look at our father Hezekiah and learn good things about him and what he did to clean house after his family had brought it to ruin. And so the good thing that we see here is what he's going to do, as verse 3 says, he opens the doors of the house of the Lord and repairs them. He immediately just busts those things open that were boarded up, and they were probably busted up because they maybe used nails to drive those things and to shut them. Maybe they busted the hinges off so these big heavy doors would just fall to the ground and wouldn't be able to be slid open anymore. Whatever it was, he looked and he saw the need, and he opened the doors and repaired them. He looked to examples of the past, which was David, his father, and he meant in his heart to do right. Verse 4 says, and he brought in the priests and Levites and gathered them together into the east street. So I said we need to look to good examples of the past. Some of us don't have dads or granddads that would fit that characteristic. Maybe they're more like Ahaz. But we can look to the examples of the scriptures and say, hey, I'm going to follow that good example of the past and I'm going to live this way. The next thing that we see this wise Hezekiah did was that he sought help from the priests that were present. Right? He looked to the past for good examples, and then he saw help from the priests that were present, from the men of God that were already around him. He brought in the priests. He brought in the Levites. He gathered them all together into the east street. Verse 5 says, and said unto them, hear me, ye Levites, sanctify now yourselves and sanctify the house of the Lord of your fathers, and carry forth the filthiness out of the holy place. What is he saying here to the men of God? He's saying, hey, sanctify or set yourselves apart. He's saying, sanctify or set apart the house of God. This is what you need to do. This is the next step that we need to do. Hezekiah looked to the past. What did they do right? Well, the first thing that they did right was they sanctified themselves. They set themselves apart. And so even these men of God needed from the king a command to get right, to get things in order, to clean house, as it were. He says, get the filthiness out of here. Get the disgustingness out of here. Get the idolatry out of here. Get the wickedness out of here. Sanctify yourselves first, then begin the work to sanctify the house of the Lord. Set it apart in your hearts and set it apart in practice presently. He calls to sanctification proper order, proper priority, proper purity for the place that they were going to do worship. And he said, start with yourselves. Now, this isn't like the poor examples did it in the past. This is a completely different thing. He's saying, hey, we did it this way, but now we're going to do things differently. And it all starts with setting yourself apart. Doesn't the Bible teach us in the New Testament that we need to be sanctified? Be ye holy, for I am holy. Be ye set apart, God commands his people. Don't follow after the poor examples of the past. Don't follow after your parents if they were wicked. Don't follow after your friends if they're wicked and not following God. Don't follow after your previous church experience. Don't follow after how you used to do things in the temple. Don't follow after your own previous ways if that's affecting you. Because quite often, we're just as affected by our own former way of doing things as we are about the surroundings that were around us. And this is why God commanded these, under the authority of the king, to first of all set themselves apart so that they could set apart the work that they were going to do. Sanctify these things, he said. Hey, let's clean house. Let's get this thing turned around. Verse 6 says, for our fathers have trespassed. We need to recognize that when we're looking at maybe our own past, or we're looking at the past of our family members, the past of the elders, the people that have went before us in the generations before us. Anytime you find these great revivals in the scriptures, they started by sanctifying themselves and then acknowledging the sins of their fathers' past. He says, for our fathers have trespassed and done that which was evil in the eyes of the Lord our God, and have forsaken him, and have turned away their faces from the habitation of the Lord and turned their backs. Also they have shut up the doors of the porch, put out the lamps, and have not burned incense nor offered burnt offerings in the holy place unto the God of Israel. Wherefore the wrath of the Lord was upon Judah and Jerusalem, and he hath delivered them to trouble, to astonishment, and to hissing, as ye see with your eyes. For lo, our fathers have fallen by the sword, and our sons and our daughters and our wives are in captivity for this. So he's recognizing that, hey, we're in a sorry state. Because of what had happened in 2 Chronicles 28, we're now in the position that we are in 2 Chronicles 29, recognizing that our sins of our fathers have put us behind. Our sins of our fathers have caused them to be fallen by the sword, have caused us to be fallen by the sword. Even our sons, even our daughters, even our wives are in captivity for all of this. We are in astonishment, we are in a hissing in the sight of our God and in the sight of those that are around us. And it's all because we have forsaken God. We have forsaken his ways. We have turned our face, we have turned our backs from what he wants for us and what he commanded us to do. Verse 10, he makes the statement, now it is in mine heart to make a covenant with the Lord God of Israel, that his fierce wrath may turn away from us, okay? So he states, hey, sanctify yourselves. Get ready to sanctify this house because I want to make a covenant with God. I want to make a promise with God that we will obey him, that we will trust in him, that we will follow after him, so that peradventure his wrath would be turned from us. Hezekiah plans to go before the Lord in his last-ditch effort to save his people, to save his kingdom, to save his own hide. He wants to go before God with a clean slate and say, God, please help us. Please forgive us our sins where we've fallen short. God, carry us from this day forward. God, would you turn your wrath away from us? Help us. And he says, hey, God, let's turn this thing around. Would you get on board with us? Hey, God, we want to clean house. We want to clean things up. We want to get this place back in order. We want to do what's right in your sight. Forgive us, Lord. And then he turns back to the people. It's like he says, hey, this is all happening. And this is what I want to go to God with and say, hey, God, we're starting fresh. We're setting things aside. You need to be on board with us, fathers. You need to be on board with us, Levites. You need to be on board with us, priests. We need to come together in unity in this and decide that we're going to get a fresh slate from God today. We're going to go with one accord and ask him for this. And he says, this is my plan, and then turns to the people and said, my sons, be not thou negligent. Don't be careless, okay? I'm going to give you a charge here. He's like, don't neglect this. Don't just put it aside. Don't be careless. Don't give it an improper order of things. This is a high priority. Don't be negligent, for the Lord hath chosen you to stand before him, to serve him, and that he should minister unto him and burn incense. He's saying, hey, this is your calling. This is your duty. This should be the utmost of your desire, because this is God's purpose and plan for your lives. You are chosen. Don't be careless here. Don't be negligent. You are chosen first to stand. The Bible says in Ephesians 6, it says, having done all to stand. Stand, stand, stand. It says it like 5 or 6 times in that same statement. He says, hey, when you can't do anything else, just stand on the promises of God. What's that mean? That means attend. That means being attentive. Be where you're supposed to be when you need to be there. Stand. Have a position. Be on guard. Be attentive. Be ready against the day of battle. Be ready against the day of peace. Be ready to fulfill your purpose. You're chosen. Don't be negligent. Don't be careless. Stand. It's your calling. It's your calling to stand before the Lord. You're to serve, the Bible says. To serve God. The Bible says in Hebrews 12, serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. With the right, appropriate fear for the Lord that has the very breath that you breathe in your hands. With the proper fear and reverence for God that made you and could wipe you out just as easy. With the reverence and godly fear of the Lord God that controls your every destiny, your every desire, your every whim. He's got these things in his control. Serve him and do it with the proper, acceptable, and righteous reverence and godly fear that you should have for him. What's the Bible saying here? When you serve him, you need to perform. You need to perform that which he desires of you. Whenever you're serving somebody, a servant does what? They have a duty, and they are to fulfill or perform it. And this is exactly what we need to do for God. Go to the scriptures, open them up, serve him by performing what he wants of us. So you're chosen first to stand, to attend unto the things of God. You're chosen secondly to serve, to perform, to do that which he has asked of you. And third, the Bible says of these people, apply it to us as well, to minister. The Bible says, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God, in 1 Peter, we're to minister. As stewards of the manifold, the wonderful, the miraculous, the awe-inspiring grace of God, as a steward of it, as one that has control over it, has care of it. God's given you his grace in order that you would bestow it upon others, that you would hold it and you would do that which was right with it. What is the Bible asking when it says to minister unto people? It says be helpful, be help, be in help, attend to the needs of others. God says you're chosen to stand before me. You're chosen to serve before me. You're chosen to minister, to help others, to encourage others, to build others up. You've been given God's grace. Now go and give it to somebody else. God's saying here. And this is what Hezekiah is charging his people. Don't be negligent. Don't be careless with these things. Hey, you were chosen to stand. You were chosen to serve. You were chosen that ye should minister unto God himself. And he says, and burn incense. This is the next thing he says. And what's that? That's to offer. That's to give. We're to be giving people. The Bible says in Ephesians 5 and verse 2, it says, walk in love as Christ also hath loved us. Okay, so there's a daunting task. Walk in love as Christ hath loved you. How were you when Christ came into your life and chose to love you? We love him because he first loved us. Ephesians charges you, walk in love as Christ also hath loved us. And look at this. And hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. God loves the smell of a gift. God loves to bask in the joy of an offering. And the best offering that he has ever received was of his own son, and it cleansed all of us from all filthiness, cleansed all of us from all wickedness, it cleansed the whole world of their unrighteousness if they would only believe. Now, as God loved you, we need to walk in that same love. As God has given himself for you, we need to give ourselves in so many areas of our lives. Self-sacrifice is what's being charged here. Remember, he said, hey, sanctify. Hey, our fathers trespassed and they did wrong and they did wickedly. Let's get a clean slate from God. And to get a clean slate from God, we need to set ourselves apart. How do we do that? Don't be negligent to what I'm about to tell you. He says, we have been chosen to first and foremost stand before God That means you're attentive, you're on guard, you're ready to do what he asks for you. Secondly, he wants you to serve him. Perform the duty that he asks of you with reverence and a godly fear. Third, you're to minister before God. You're to help others. You're to help him in the things that he wants to do in this world. You're to be a servant to God. You're to minister before others and to offer, to give yourself, to give your resources, to give your time, to give your efforts, to give your energy. You're to spend and be spent, the Bible says. The Apostle Paul was pretty beaten up later in his life, and he said, I love to be spent of you. I would prefer it to just pour myself out into ministering, into offering, into serving, and into standing for God's people. Why? Because that's what God did for him, and he recognized it. The more we meditate upon what God has done for us, like it says in Ephesians, walk in love as Christ also hath loved us. The more we think about how much Christ has loved us, the more daunting the task comes to love others. But if we ask for the love of God, we shall receive the love of God, and you should be able to greatly and more appropriately bestow those unto others. This is the thing that we're chosen to, even as these priests and these Levites of times past. We are chosen to fulfill these things. We're to attend. We're to perform. We're to help. We're to give. And I love the Bible. I'm just going to, in the next three verses, focus on the beginning there of verse 12. It says, then the Levites arose. Then the Levites arose, okay? You just got this charge to stand, to serve, to minister, to offer. And the first thing that they do, it was recorded of them, they arose. They got up. They got to the task. They were ready. They did exactly what, through the king, God had commanded by the word of God. And that's what it says. If you just skip over to 2 Chronicles 29, verse 15, it says, and they gathered their brethren and sanctified themselves and came according to the commandment of the king by the words of the Lord to cleanse the house of the Lord. They showed the exact right attitude. Now, obviously, we have a list of names there. We're not going to go over the actuals, the particulars of who was involved here. But we see that they rose to the challenge. They rose to the opportunity. They stood up and said, okay, this is what we need to do. This is what we're ready to do. The right attitude they put forward. And when it comes to submitting on authorities, this is exactly how we need to do. When the word of the king comes forth, take it as the word of the Lord. The Bible here records that it is the very words of God. It says the commandment of the king by the word of the Lord was here to cleanse the house of the Lord and to get that thing moving. But when we're in any kind of submission to authority opportunity in our lives, we need to do the same thing. Whether it's me unto my boss, whether it's kids unto their parents, whether it's church member unto the preacher, whatever the area of authority that we're placed under, if it's not contradicting Scripture in any way, you take the words, the commandment of the king, like the Bible says here, as the words of the Lord, and you go forward. And that's the right attitude. By default, they heard the charge, and everything that was being charged them at that time was completely biblical. There's nothing unbiblical about standing before God, serving before God, ministering before God, and offering before God. And so when that charge came forward, they took it as the very words of God, and they rose up, and they were ready for what was before them. And in my experience, and I will tell you this, young folks, that I have gotten way further in my life when I chose to just willingly obey the authorities that were before me. Okay, in my job, I used to always think that I had it right. I used to always think that I knew what was right, the right thing to do at the right time. And when my direct authority came to me and said, hey, you need to do this, often I would be like, ah, no, that's a dumb idea. And I would voice it. I would say, you know what, we should do this. We should do something else. There's a better way of doing things. This is going to mess up. And sometimes I was right, okay? Sometimes I was dead on with my analysis of the situation, but I had the wrong attitude. And because I had the wrong attitude, I was wrong even though I was right. You can be right with the wrong attitude and wrong with the right attitude. That happens all the time. But the Bible records above all things that we should have the right motive in dealing with authorities in our life. And so at some point in my life, the Bible clicked with me. And I took the commandment of the king, who is just a person that was in my boss at work, only because at the time he'd served and the position that he was given, I took the words of that man as if they were the very words of God. And when he said, hey, do this, I didn't understand it. I didn't think it was the right idea. I thought he was dead wrong in his command. But I said, all right, and I just did it. And since I've made that conscious decision in areas of authority that I've been under, whether it be a boss, whether it be a pastor, or whether it be parents, whatsoever, whoever has the authority over me in a particular position, I have seen great growth. And you will go far in that. Not only in my position, now where that same boss that I had, that I was always kicking against him, when I chose to yield myself unto him, do you know the Lord put me above him? Currently in my job position, I make calls that affect his daily life. And he asked me for things and asked me for direction and for guidance. And it's all because I believe I did as the Bible says, and I took the command of the king, the parents, the preacher, whoever is in authority over you, as the words of God, and just did it as unto the Lord. Doesn't the Bible says that we're supposed to serve as unto Christ? We're supposed to do everything in our life as unto Christ? Well, then we should take that principle and we should attach it even as these Levites did. And they did it with the right attitude. They submitted to the authority. They said, hey, we will go and we will do this. And the thing that you got to notice too is they didn't do it with lip service, right? They didn't just say, yeah, we'll do that, and then didn't do it. They didn't do it with eye service and say, yeah, I'll totally do that. And then when the boss turns away, when the king turns away, they're doing something else, right? They're just kind of eye service, lip service. They're only going to do what they're supposed to when the eyes are on them, or they're only going to say what they're going to do. That's the wrong attitude, too. That's completely wicked. You need to recognize that, hey, you're doing things as unto God. Well, God's eyes are everywhere. God's ears are everywhere. God's going to see these things coming to pass, including the things that are in your heart. We need to not do our submission to authorities as our own hearts would dictate. We're to do it as the Bible says. As it says in verse 16, it says, and the priests went into the inner part of the house of the Lord to cleanse it, and brought out all the uncleanness that they found in the temple of the Lord into the court of the house of the Lord. And the Levites took it to carry it out abroad into the brook Kidron. And I love this. So that first little portion there. And the priests went into the inner part of the house. Okay? So the Bible records that the charge was given to get things cleaned up. Sanctify yourself and sanctify the house of God. Then the charge comes forward where he says, hey, you're chosen to stand, you're chosen to serve, you're chosen to minister, you're chosen to offer. It's like the pep talk that he's given to encourage people into the work that they have to do. Then they gathered themselves and they said, hey, yeah, we will do these things according to the commandment of the king. Were it even the commandment of the Lord of hosts himself, we're going to do these things. We're going to cleanse the house of the Lord. And the response in verse 16, the priest went into, the Bible says, the inner part. They just jumped right into the inner part. They just got into the thick of it. You know, if you think about something that's been condemned for a long time and you're cleaning, maybe it's an old dingy house and somebody, you know, you work for a contractor and they're going to turn this house around. Let's say, you know, the worst kind of scenario that we could imagine here. I know here there was just like idols going on, but beasts maybe had crept in and had made a mess of things. You think about a condemned house. What if the person had like 40 cats in there? And there's just waste and filth and disgust from that. What if they were some kind of hoarder and they just had all this garbage in there? And this is the whole reason why they condemned this place. This old cat lady passed away, and her family didn't want anything to do with this house. So they just put up to sale this garbage. But then this contractor comes along, this king, as it were, and he's like, I want something to do with this house. I want to sell this house. I want to turn around. So he asks his priests and his Levites. He asks his men. He says, hey, I need to clean this thing. This thing needs to be cleaned. And we would be like, oh, you get 5 feet away from this house and you can smell the cat pee. You can smell the dung. You can smell the waste. I don't know if you've ever been in these situations. I once worked for a pizza place and somebody ordered pizza and I came to the door and I didn't notice anything until he opened the door, and literally there was like the line where the door opens and garbage this deep. And the smell that came out of this place literally made me like jump back. And I threw the pizza to him and ran away. And I went back to my boss and I'm like, that one's on me. I don't even want to touch his money. But if you've ever experienced something like that, that's the kind of thing that you can imagine that these would have faced when they came to this. Because he says, hey, get the filthiness out of here. Get the disgustingness out of the house of the Lord. Clean this place. Sanctify this place. But the spirit that was in these Levites drove them to just jump into the inner part. Now think of that place. It's just disgusting. You can't even go near it. And you're asked to clean it. And you don't just come and like, you know, delicately kind of clean up the door first and then work your way in. No, these Levites jumped right into the mess, right into the middle of this thing and just started cleaning. The Bible records here that they found all sorts of uncleanness. Go to the back of the Bible and look what's unclean in the Bible. They found all of this stuff in the temple, and what they do, they pulled it out took it and carried it out to the brook Kidron. They removed it far from the place, and they I believe threw it in water, or they threw it near, you know, maybe there's a dump there or something. They just got it out of the house of the Lord. But they went first to the inner part. They didn't discreetly or gently just kind of clean up around. No, they just got right in there. They're willing of themselves to offer themselves. And us too, we need to have that same attitude. Verse 17 says, now they began on the first day of the first month to sanctify, and on the 18th day of the month they came to the porch of the Lord. So they sanctified the house of the Lord in 8 days, and in the 16th day of the first month they made an end. And it's interesting, I mean, I was kind of just going in my Bible reading a little bit, and this verse just came up to me because I thought, you know, this is pretty fitting. We're going to try to clean this place up a little bit today to prepare for what? Something coming on the 16th day. Before I even read it, the Bible is saying that they finished their work on the 16th day. Next week, we're going to finish our work on the 16th day when this thing will be prepared and things will be ready to perform the service of the house of God. I just found that was really interesting. Thank you, Lord, for that. But back to the context, in verse 18 it says, then they went into Hezekiah the king and said, we have cleansed all the house of the Lord, and the altar of the burnt offering, with all the vessels thereof, and the showbread table, and all the vessels thereof. Moreover, all the vessels which King Ahaz in his reign did cast away in his transgression, have we prepared and sanctified, behold, there before the altar of the Lord. So they come and they bring this report to the king. They say basically, hey, all of the items that were used in the service of God, we have collected, we have fixed. All of the items that are needed, including the altar, the table of the showbread, are in their proper position. We have cleansed, we have sanctified, we have taken away and cast out the transgression of our fathers beforehand. This thing looks just as it would had he not made a mess of it. They come and they bring this report, and they say everything that was amiss, everything that was a mess, everything that was wrong, we have, as you requested, behold it, the statement is made, behold, behold, have a look, come see, king, and see the work that I have done. But it's interesting here because the king's not worried. Now, when you say a job is done, do your parents have to check up on it right away? When you say a job is done, does your boss have to come and make sure that you actually did it right? When you say something is done, when your word is that, hey, I've done what I was told, do the people that have commanded you to do such a work often have to follow up on you? It's interesting because the heart of the Levites was such, they jumped in the mess. They got the job done. They did it exactly. The first statement that they made to the king was, hey, hey, behold, behold, we have cleansed it. Behold, everything is before the Lord. That's at the end of verse 19, actually. It says, behold, they are before the Lord. Hey, come and see it, king. But look what happens next. It says, then Hezekiah the king arose early. The king didn't go and behold right away. He didn't go and check out and make sure they had done what he was asked. He trusted in his men enough, the Spirit of God working in them. And we Christians need to be as accountable that when we say, hey, behold, everything is done. Behold, they are before the altar of the Lord. Talking about all the vessels and all of the furnishings and all of the things that are needed for the service. Everything is just back to the way it was before the transgression. Behold it. Our boss, our parents, our preacher just goes to bed. He just considers it done. He doesn't go and check out on them. He doesn't go and make sure and come down there and sleuth everything out. No, he just goes, good, thanks, goes to bed. He's comfortable enough with his men. And as Christians, our word needs to be like that. We need to say, hey, I did it. And when I say, hey, I did it, then our parents, then our bosses, then our authorities that are over us will go, good, it's done. Our word needs to be good like that. Even as these priests, these Levites' word was good. Good enough that their boss was like, all right, I can rest easy. Then Hezekiah, verse 20 says, the king rose early, gathered the rulers of the city, and went to the house of the Lord. Look, he didn't even go ahead and then make sure that everything was done as he had asked. He brought everybody with full assurance and confidence that his men, his person that he had asked to do the specific task, had done it exactly as it was asked. And he showed up with the intent to worship, with the intent right away to get into what was about to be performed. He didn't need to check up on them. He didn't need to go early. He just went to bed. He trusted in his guys. Verse 21 says this. It says, and they brought 7 bullocks and 7 rams and 7 lambs for the offering, and that continues on. All the way down to verse 24, we see the killing of the bullocks played out. We see the sprinkling of the blood upon the altar. We see the he-goats brought as a sin offering, which is going to be for the king and the congregation and for the work of the Lord that was there. And in verse 24 it says, and the priests killed them, and they made, I love this word, reconciliation with their blood upon the altar to make atonement for all Israel, for the king commanded that the burnt offering and the sin offering should be made for all Israel. So all that has played out was to the end that now they come forward, they bring the ram, they bring the lamb, they bring the bullocks, they bring everything needed for the altar. The priest kills them to make reconciliation with the blood and all those things. Now that things are in order, now that the filthiness is gone, now that the people are sanctified and the house is sanctified, what happens? The sacrifice takes place. The service takes place. The appropriate next step, the goal of all this was to come to God, remember? To stand before the Lord and to say, hey, God, we need a clean slate. God, we need you to get on board with us. God, we need you to forgive us for all of our sins and all of our iniquities. And that was fulfilled when Hezekiah walked in early in the morning, bringing the offerings to a clean house, to a spotless house, to a house appropriately laid out with the proper furnishings. Everything's good to go. Everything's clean. The lambs, the ewes have arrived. And this is exactly what he desired to do, was as verse 24, stand before God and say, God, we need reconciliation. Here's the blood. God, we need atonement to be made. We need a substitute to go in our place. We need our sin to be upon this lamb so that we can be cleansed. Now, regarding salvation, I am thankful that we don't need to work and do all sorts of things. We don't need to get the house clean and swept up before we can go and get atonement, do we? We don't need to go and to get all the filthiness out of our temple. We don't need to go and to clean everything up, get right into the dirtiness of our lives and make sure that's all cleaned up before we can come get reconciliation by the blood and atonement to come to our lives. We don't need anything that to be saved. But it's a good principle that we can grab hold of here, that now once we are saved, and the Bible refers to the men that are being talked to, the Levites and the priests, they would be considered typologically as Christians, as believers. They would have got things in order, got things clean, repented of their sins, turned from their wicked ways as believers, come to God and then say, God, forgive us our sins, forgive us our trespasses. Again, we don't have this same order. It's almost a reverse order for us. From the blood, we ask for forgiveness, and then the house gets cleaned, and then the house gets garnished, and then everything gets set in order. But for these priests, in order to get the service right, they first clean the thing. You see how there's a difference there? Our service has to be clean so we can come to God and have him to get on board with what is going forward. Whereas when it comes to salvation, we just go to God. He's already done the works. The blood is ready for reconciliation. They're ready for atonement. But here in the area of service, again, they clean that house. They get the conscience cleared, right? They get all of the filthiness out as a type. They come to God with a clean record, and then the priest comes and he kills. He makes reconciliation with the blood. The forgiveness of God comes upon the people as a whole. The service is complete, and what is next is a celebration. Verse 25 says, and he set the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals, with psalteries, with harps, according to the commandment of David and of Gad the king's seer and Nathan the prophet, for so was the commandment of the Lord by his prophets. The celebration begins. The celebration there in verse 25, it comes with cymbals. It comes with psalteries and harps, stringed instruments. It comes according to, and what the Bible says here, according to David, according to Gad the king's seer, according to Nathan the prophet, and finally, for so was the commandment of the Lord by his prophets. And I think sometimes as Baptists we get a little bit uptight. We get a little bit tense. As soon as you start to hear maybe a rhythm, somebody's clapping during song service or stomping their feet, right? Somebody's getting a little bit excited here. You need to kind of keep that austere and tight and regimented look to you. But here it says, and it records that once the house was clean, once the service was ready, once they had brought their offerings before God with a clean conscience, with a clean heart before him, the priest killed and sins were atoned for. because of the shedding of the blood here in the Old Testament. And then immediately after began the next stage, and that was the celebration. The percussion instruments come in. The stringed instruments come in. And this wasn't just David acting out in his flesh. The Bible records that this was the commandment of David, the commandment of the king's seer, the commandment of the prophet. Very commandments of God were to bring these instruments and to celebrate and to rejoice. Why? Because once that blood comes upon you, isn't it a good feeling? Isn't it satisfy you? Even in your own Christian life, you've backslidden in your life the short while you've been saved. You've done wrong to your parents. You've done wrong in your job. You've done wrong in your life. You said the wrong thing. You've thought the wrong thing. You've looked at the wrong thing. But the Bible says that, hey, if we should confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And as a nation, this is what happened to them in verse 24. They came, and as the priests, at the end of verse 23, they laid their hands on these animals, and when they slew them, those animals took upon them as a picture the sins of the whole nation, and reconciliation was made when that blood was placed upon the altar. The atonement, the substitution was made, and they were forgiven, and the first thing they want to do is just shout it. They want to scream. They want to yell. They want to celebrate, and they're going to bring out the percussion instruments. They're going to bring out the strings, right? The guitars come out, and everyone's rejoicing and singing. That's what psalteries and harps are. They're just different types of string instruments. We don't need to be so rigid in our Christianity, because the Bible definitely prescribes, God commands, prophets commands, and King David, who penned most of the scriptures from his heart, said, hey, get these instruments out and celebrate, sing with joy and happiness unto the Lord. Come by commandment, bring these items, celebrate and rejoice in the fact that you have been reconciled by the blood. The atonement has been made. We are cleansed. Don't we feel light when these things have left our backs? Verse 28 or 26 continues and says, and the Levites stood with the instruments of David, and the priests with their trumpets. And so trumpets are now added. The brass instruments come to place where now they're blowing with the trumpets in celebration. Verse 27 and verse 28 adds, and Hezekiah commanded to offer the burnt offering upon the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord began also with trumpets and with instruments ordained by David, the king of Israel. And all the congregation worshipped, and the singers sang, and the trumpeters sounded, and all this continued until the burnt offering was finished. The singers are now at it, and they're singing their songs unto God. They're singing praises unto God. The congregation comes together and they're worshiping, and they're just enjoying the time that they have now in what the Bible calls worship and praise. In verse 29 it says, and when they had made an end of offering, the king and all that were present with them bowed themselves and worshipped. Moreover, Hezekiah the king and the princes commanded the Levites to sing praise unto the Lord with words of David and of Asaph the seer. And what's that? The words of David and of Asaph? Those are the psalms that we have recorded in our Bible. And they sang praises with gladness, and they bowed their heads in worship. We get uncomfortable with those terms, praise and worship, but isn't the Bible commanding that right now? Yeah. Praise and worship unto Him, rejoicing unto Him. Yes, it came on the heels of a great spiritual revival, and that's good. We should do these things. We should see these types of revivals in our life. Verse 31 says that Hezekiah answered and said, now ye have consecrated yourselves unto the Lord. Come near and bring sacrifices and thank offerings into the house of the Lord. And the congregation brought in sacrifices and thank offerings, as many as were of a free heart, burnt offerings. So the joy and the rejoicing that came after this great cleansing of the temple, after they cleaned house, as it were, after they cleaned themselves up, as it were, they come and they worship and they praise, and it's followed up with thanksgiving. Not just a little bit of, you know, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul, and those little hymns that we sing to ourselves. But they were so excited about what had happened in this moment that there was so much thanksgiving above and beyond all of the 7 bullocks and the 7 rams and the 7 he-goats and the 7, the abundance of offerings that were made to cleanse the temple, to cleanse them of their sins, to bring reconciliation to the people. Above and beyond that, verse 32, it says, and the number of the burnt offerings, and these were the thank offerings. These were even after
God, they had done the proper order. Even after they had rejoiced and celebrated together, they were just so abundantly full and wanted to give more that verse 32 says the number of the burnt offerings which the congregation brought was 70 bullocks and 100 rams and 200 lambs. It's a bigger offering than the one they made to cleanse them of their sins. All these were for a burnt offering, and the consecrated things were 600 oxen and 3,000 sheep. The Bible says the priests were too few so that they could not flay all the burnt offerings. And so there's so much abundantly offerings coming into this celebration that the priests can't even keep up. They can't even do what they're intended to do. It's interesting, if you were to go back, you were to find that the priests... I'm looking for it now. It was the Levites, right, in verse 12 that arose, right? We didn't see the priests arising or given honorable mention for this. And we see what had happened is that in verse 34, the priests were too few so that they could not flay the burnt offerings. Wherefore, remember those Levites that had the big heart to serve? Remember those Levites that had the big heart to do right? The Levites that took the charge to stand, to serve, to minister, to offer before God. They took it seriously. They weren't messing around when they jumped into the heart of the mess. Remember those same Levites? They had that same mind to continue in these things. Wherefore, it says in verse 34, wherefore their brethren, the Levites, did help them till the work was ended, until all the other priests had sanctified themselves. It seemed like the priests had kind of been through this rigmarole before, and they thought they might see a little bit of a revival, but that they could keep up with some things. The Bible records that some of the priests hadn't even sanctified themselves. They hadn't even prepared themselves for the great spiritual revival that had come upon this people, that had come by the commandment of a king that had a heart towards God, that wanted to get rid of the sins of the past and start it right. These priests weren't prepared for those things, but the Levites were. The Bible says the Levites were more upright in heart to sanctify themselves than the priests. So we need to be more upright in heart than the religious folks around us. As a core group, as a congregation here, we need to be as these Levites with the right heart, the right attitude, the right spirit to serve in the house of God. What do we need to do? Stand, serve, minister, and offer. Don't be negligent or careless concerning these things. And that's what the Levites did. They were so prepared to finish their work that when they found some of these religious priests that couldn't keep up with the duty that was set before them, they just were like, all right, we've already been dealing with filth in the house of God. We've already cleansed this thing. We've already been celebrating and rejoicing. We can do this too. They rolled up their sleeves and they started flaying beasts. They started preparing them for the sacrifices of thanksgiving that were abundantly beyond the sacrifice of atonements that were made at this time. There were so many of them, they couldn't keep up, but these faithful Levites decided, hey, we can get involved in this. We can go and we can serve. We can go and set an order. We can go and do all these things that are our duty. But above and beyond that, we can do so much more. The Bible says in verse 35, the burnt offerings were in abundance, and with the fat of the peace offerings and the drink offerings for every burnt offering, so the service of the house of the Lord was set in order. Verse 36 says, and Hezekiah rejoiced, and all the people that had prepared, or all the people that God had prepared the people, for the thing was done suddenly. I think even Hezekiah was just like, wow. This was something that a 25-year-old young man had set upon his heart. He became king, and he's like, I know that my fathers have sinned. I know that my fathers have done wickedly. I want to start afresh. I want to go, he says, before the Lord. Hear now, you Levites, sanctify yourselves. He charges them. He's like, sanctify the house of God. Get this thing cleaned up. Get this wickedness taken out. Get this uncleanness, unsavory filth that's in our house out of here. Why? Because I plan, it's in my heart, to make a covenant with the Lord God of Israel to get his wrath turned away. His heart and his desire was to simply have his nation before God clean, before God right, before God without wrath, but with the joy that comes. And in verse 36, it came to pass, he rejoiced. And all the people rejoiced with him that God had prepared the people for such a time as this. And he rejoices all the more because this thing was done suddenly. The service was set in order suddenly. The house was cleaned suddenly. The people were prepared and sanctified suddenly. The atonement was made suddenly. All in a few days we had come to this celebration. Offerings are coming. Everyone's excited. The revival had come. Service was now back in order. The Bible says it was in order. The house of the Lord, the service of it was in order. He's rejoicing that it happened so suddenly. And how did it happen? Same way it happens for us now. There's a need. There's a burden. There's a charge. There's obedience to all of those sacrifices made. Praise and worship comes. Thanksgiving and then the overabundant joy. And it's just like a cycle of these things that keep coming and coming and coming. So the practicals that we can get out of this are, first and foremost, we need to keep this house clean. Right? We need to keep this building clean. We need to keep it ordered. We need to keep it right. We need to, if we spill something, own up to it, right? Didn't these people own up to it? They said, hey, God, we have sinned before thee, right? Well, this is just an office building to somebody that looks from the inside out. But to us, it's the very house of God. This is the place that Sound Words Baptist Church chooses to worship. And when we're in here for these 3 hours every Sunday, we say, this is the house of the Lord, and we need to treat it as such. We need to keep this house clean. Now, when this house comes clean, it comes on the heels of clean bodies, right? Because the Bible records that he charged them first to sanctify themselves, then sanctify the house. So they came with a heart, a temple of the Holy Ghost, the furnishings ready, right? They had read the verses. They had studied the Bible. They had prayed and meditated. We need to come with that right spirit and that right heart to the house of God, prepared to do what is the service. We need to set those things in order. So first and foremost, get your hearts clean. Get the temple clean. Secondly, get this building clean, right? We're going to do that in a little bit from now, right? We're going to clean this thing up. We're going to make it nice for God. Why? Because we have an end. And the end is that on the 16th, just as it was in this verse, we're on the 16th, we're going to have an event here that is going to be special. But this isn't something that I want to be just a practical for a big event when a preacher comes to visit us. I want this to be week in and week out that we treat this place, that it's the very house of God. That means entering with a clean body, prepared. If you need to sit out in your car for an extra 10 minutes to pray and meditate, get the world out of your mind and get focused that you're going to be here to hear the word of God and to rejoice in the word of God and to hear the preaching and to sing praises unto him. If you need to sit out here for another 10 minutes just to make sure that you're right when you walk in here, I rejoice in that. Ideally, we should do that 10 minutes before that, get to church on time, be prepared for the service. But that's what the Bible, I believe, prescribes. Get that house clean. Get this house clean. Keep it clean. And then rejoice with thanksgiving. The Bible says, rejoice with thanksgiving. That's what these people did, right? They got into the mess. They got into the filth. They cleaned this thing up. They cleaned their bodies up. They prepared for the service that was going to take place. And after the service had taken place, there was abundantly more service that wasn't even prepared. It wasn't ordered on the schedule to bring 600 different offerings, to bring just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, abundantly more than what was prescribed in the service. But that's what we get here when we come, when we prepare our hearts for the service, we receive what God has for us, and we get that fellowship afterwards. We get that abundant joy. We get that overwhelming of the offerings. We get more and more and more what God has for us. That's what we can rejoice with thanksgiving. That's what this Bible is teaching here. Hey, clean the house. We're cleaning house today, but the Bible wants us to clean house every day, every week. Sanctify your hearts. Sanctify this house. Be prepared for the things that God has for us. And rejoice when he gives us exactly as he promised. Thank you for